You are now about to witness the strength of street knowledge.
Let's discover hard cover months, but it's existence. It's enough so you can know what's up in the hood.
Gentrification. When working class and or inner city neighborhoods are converted into more affluent middle class communities as by remodeling buildings, resulting in increased property values and in displacement of the poor.
I moved
every year up until I was in about
6th grade.
Well, originally where I was born at, where I lived at until I was about 6 months, I lived on the west side. Then we moved to the, I think from either the west side to the south side or from the south side to the west side. I can't remember which. Then we found a place up northwest. Then we had to move where Burger King is at to a different place. Then after that, we stayed in the basement, moved from the basement into the third floor in a Hispanic housing. And so I stayed there until I was about 12.
Walking down my street, I'm usually too busy on my cell phone to notice anything unusual. Starbucks and an antique boutique, what's new? As I pass the second sunshine tanning salon and the sushi surplus, I can't seem to put my finger on it just yet. I see a bench, and since I have walked a couple of blocks, and after all, I am a big girl, I decide to sit. And then it hits me, and it hits me hard, this epiphany, the chances of us stopping this genocide to stomp out my Boricua pride is as likely as me doing a somersault and landing into a split. Where Lorenzo used to have his famous alcapurrias for 75 cents is now quite concrete and cold. You see, before it had this Afro, Caribe, salsa, merengue, adobo, soul. I'm just repulsed and sickened by these lively homes turned into morbid houses, condos, and what exactly is a Venetian complex? Is it because I don't look like a banana threw up on my head? Is it because I don't frequent the neighborhood hookah bar? How about you take the fact that I won't allow for you to turn Humboldt into a dog park or Clemente into a Windsor Pilates studio that'll offer spinning classes, yoga, not to mention step aerobics, and stuff that in your hookah pipe and smoke it.
One of the challenges that all communities face where you have a tremendous amount of reinvestment is a displacement, as you indicated. However, the question and the issue is not should not just be viewed as one of just simply one factor or one element. It has to be viewed upon with a holistic and approach in a holistic manner. As I just indicated, economic development, quality health care, education are important in maintaining the balance and maintaining diversity in communities. Diverse communities are the healthiest communities, and we need to embrace that and we need to encourage that. However, you're not going to be able to maintain diversity if you don't offer access and if you don't offer opportunities to the resources that do exist. So the most important goal and priority is making sure that you give people the necessary tools and resources to be able to take advantage of what is out there.
Affordable housing for people is something that is definitely a necessity in this community because of things that happened historically, our people can't necessarily have finances that people of privilege generally have and can't afford to buy houses off the bat like that. We have to have it be a process, really, where we rent and save up so that we can later on invest in our housing. It's just not something we can do automatically like that. A lot of this area has been gentrified. You see the condos that are built that we can't afford. You see the hookah bars. You see the tanning salons. You see all of that. But our job is to stay here and make sure that that doesn't happen anymore and that we preserve this neighborhood that we struggled to have for this long.
The history of Humboldt Park community is diverse and complicated. Germans and Scandinavians came to Chicago in the 1800s and founded Humboldt Park. Then came the Norwegians in the 1920s, followed by Italian, Polish, and Jewish immigrants in the 1930s.
Humboldt Park gets its name from a 920-acre park named for Alexander von Humboldt, a German naturalist. The creation of Humboldt and several other West Side parks provided beauty for the surrounding community, which drew many different types of people to live here. Most of the European people who lived in Humboldt Park after World War II were middle class. However, in the 1970s and 80s, more than 30,000 people lost their jobs, and many of them left the neighborhood.
The Latinos who came in the 1980s are the latest immigrant group to find a home in Humboldt Park, and this is reflected in the area surrounding it. Along Division Street, the neighborhood's northern boundaries is the mile-long stretch known as Paso Boricua, or the Puerto Rican Passage. Two enormous steel Puerto Rican flags stand at either end of this corridor, signifying the powerful Puerto Rican influence in the area.
Today, the population of Humboldt Park is primarily made up of Puerto Ricans and African Americans. It is a working class community where 31% of the population is below the poverty level and 19% are unemployed. Despite these higher than average numbers, Humboldt Park is a thriving cultural center, especially for the Puerto Rican community. But this cultural center is changing rapidly. Many older buildings throughout Humboldt Park have been knocked down and replaced by expensive condos that few current residents can afford. As property taxes rise, landlords are forced to raise the rent, thereby displacing long-time residents, many of whom are Puerto Rican. Many displaced residents are forced to move to more expensive or overcrowded places. 80 to 85% of displaced people have to pay more for worse accommodation.
But displacement doesn't happen without a fight. One way to ensure that the residents are not displaced is to change the ownership structure of the land and building.
Because Humboldt Park is the center of a particular ethnic community, displacement of the working class residents also means potential destruction of the Puerto Rican community. This displacement is anti-democratic because it denies self-determination to the existing community.
Well, this community actually is slowly but surely being gentrified, and I refuse to move off of Paseo Boricua. Living here and staying here and supporting programs like Bricker and organizations like Brickerdike and Bate Urbano and the Puerto Rican Cultural Center and DSBDA and all these other programs that exist here in Paseo, that's our way of keeping this neighborhood what it is, keeping it a predominantly Puerto Rican neighborhood community or Latino community where we can all support each other. That's our way of making sure that this place stays here and it stays operating the way that we want it to, so that people can live at a standard that they deserve to live in.
I'm Alderman Billy Ocasio of the 26th Ward. My community is very diverse. I have a predominant Puerto Rican community, and we have a big Mexican community. I have about 13% of the residents are African American. About 12% of them are Caucasian. Primary issues facing the community right now, I'd say number one has to be housing. The biggest crisis we have, not only in this community but in the city of Chicago, is trying to find affordable rental housing and affordable home ownership opportunities. That's the biggest crisis throughout the whole city. So if any private developer wants to come into our community and build, they have to come in front of the community first and show them what it is that they want to do and explain to them what they're going to do. And unless that developer has an affordable part of their building, an affordable component, meaning that they're going to provide some of the affordable units, 30% affordable, then we just don't allow them to build. I think that's the biggest thing we could do for displacement, is making sure that we're providing and creating as many affordable units as possible.
I stand up, keep walking, paying more attention. Now I'm hungry, not only for change, because after all, I am a big girl. Bacalao and beyond, I'm mouth watering. Sentimana Cafe, Leticia's Organic Bakery, Flying Saucers. Wait. How is it that with all these abuelas and tías around here, there isn't one decent place in sight anymore? I can get a mista or a sazon seasoned chicken thigh. Can I at least get a large bustelo? Bustelo, man, that sounds hip, man. Where can I get some of that? Is it French, man? You can't have it, you poser, it's mine. My best friend Ziggy's dreads, they're his. My brother, he owns a Sean John and Tim's. What's next? A Mini Cooper sitting on 20 inch trims blasting La Tierra de Borinquen.
My name is Joy Arruguete, and I'm the executive director at Bickerdike Redevelopment Corporation. The demographics, or who lives in our community, are still pretty telltale. We have a phenomenal amount of low-income people that still live in our community. And the type of housing that's being built is all for people who have to earn quite a bit of money, who are at the upper end of the income scale. So what that means is that people who live in the community are either going to have to double up, triple up, or they're going to have to move out of the community where their church is located, where the school is located, where the parks are located, where their friends are located, and it really tears the community apart.
Hi.
Middle Eastern themes, Arabian dreams. Don't fake being Japanese just to feed me sushi, please. No VIP or Banana Republican jeans. Would you listen as closely to me if I talk like this? Or push me out of the way because I have empty pockets. You see, my pockets, they may be empty, but my soul's definitely not. It's not hollow like that of a yuppie's beatnik spot. It's not hollow like my parents' hearts who refused to teach me Espanol and who allowed for the media to take control and make them typical 100% all-American. I just haven't forgotten, you see, that I'm part Taino, Indian, and African as well. I just haven't forgotten that I am part Taino, Indian, and African. I will not forget that we are all part Taino, Indian, and African. And I won't forget that I'm also a big girl. Thank you.
Good morning and welcome to the groundbreaking of La Estancia. Bienvenidos a todos. Alderman Ocasio is an alderman with vision and the perseverance to make the Humboldt Park community a great place and the guts to make sure that longtime residents of this community get to enjoy living in such a fabulous place.
There are some projects that need to be done. There are some projects where people had to play a leadership role, but it's about doing the right thing. And I think that that's what we're here about today.
Let me just say, today's event is really about a community that comes together. That it's not only about dreaming, but it's making it happen. It's making it happen, and I think that that's what Bickerdijk and the rest of the organizations and the people of this community have done today, is make a dream come true.
All of the inspiration that I get and all of the inspiration that I need is for my community and the work that I do in the community, for the people of this community who have lived here for decades now. And my poetry really is a form of stating and addressing the issues that happen in this community, such as gentrification. Programs like La Estancia and Bickerdijk allow for affordable housing so that people can have somewhere to live while they work and take care of their families and raise their families in a community that's supporting to them. And here on Paso Boricua.
This is based on a series of true stories. This is for real. Check it. Johnny 5'11, age 1'7. Just a young black male trying to be home before 11. Catches glancing awkward stares from every direction. Since it's straight from Range, always waiting at the intersection. Johnny just finished playing hoops at Lincoln Park. The last thing he wanted was some trouble to spark. But still, yuppies grab their purses cause his skin's real dark. Johnny's a smart kid. He's on the debate team, on a roll, student council, to score shining gleam, but he still stays out west, rocks his pants below his butt, he has braids in his hair, and he walks with a strut. Johnny's almost there, he can see him and stop, but uh-oh, 5-0.
Pilsen neighborhood is Chicago's largest Latino community. One of the many murals and neighborhood buildings have expressed the history of struggles and social protest over the years. In the 1970s, a critical problem of quality education in the community was focused on Throwback High. 70% of the students there had dropped out by 1973 because the conditions were intolerable. Parents and students participated in a march to demonstrate their vital need for a new school. As a result, in 1977, a new school was built called Benito Juarez High School. Doors opened in 1978 and a new mural was commissioned to celebrate this triumph of the Pilsen community. This is the story of that mural.
There were four people in a competition with three designs.
Salvador Vega's design, Malu's, and Jaime's design, which are working in conjunction. Actually, Malu was the one that came up with the colors. And Jaime put the line, or, well, the line, and my design. And the way it was just is that they put several people from the community on, and a few teachers, I think, if I'm not correct. I think there were three from Benito Juarez High School. Okay, but the art program director, there's a group from a community which it's represented by a guy named Valadez, and he's like a president from a group from a community, and several, you must say, directors from the community, like Pilsen Neighbors, which and about 8 or 9 housewives.
Now, we, as a committee, we asked for this contest, and they all prepared something. Everybody had a mural all prepared, and they showed it all to us, the mural committee. We called the council, the rest of the Benito Juarez Advisory Council, we called them together and asked and told them, so these are the entries. We can all look at them, and we decide which one we want. Each one of the artists explained their work, and then we retired and went to another room, and we all decided then, and it was by vote, and they all picked the one by Jaime Longoria and Malu Ortega.
El motivo de que yo voté por el mural es el conjunto con todas las ideas de mis compañeros, es lo mismo. El dibujo es algo diferente a lo que ya tenemos. Hay muchos murales por todo el barrio, pero siempre representan el mismo, oh, ¿cómo podría explicarme? Lo mismo, ¿verdad? ¿Cómo podría decir? Lucha. La lucha y las mismas fotografías de Dolores y de todo eso, ¿verdad? La esclavitud y todo. Y esto se nos figuró que es algo para nosotros moderno, un poco más moderno.
Well, personally, when I paint a mural, I try to be as realistic as possible. Try to give a message, right? But on this wall, I like it because it's different, because we're painting it. I never painted a mural the way we're painting this particular wall. And like I say, it's a lot of people disagree with the wall, and it's obvious because they are used to seeing murals painted in a strictly Chicano sort of thing, you know. And as time goes by, and times changes, so does the artist. The artist has to expose himself to change. Otherwise, there is no point in being an artist if you don't change.
Some of that blue in there, kind of real strong, real light, delicate streaks like Maestro was using over here. Yeah. That's real electric. Uh-huh. And except, you know, without the white jazz. You know, like you did at the other end, you put in that yellow. You invented that yellow in there, which brought it out. That might be nice to have this kind of come out, because when I snare it with the black lines, then it becomes real active. And I need a lot of force on this figure here. So if we can get that. by and large, guys are so good that, you know, you just tell them, this is what I'd like to see, and then they do something, and oftentimes it's more than I expected. And it's just incredible stuff that we're doing here.
My name is Malu Ortega y Alberro. This is the first time I paint a mural, and the idea came when we knew we were going to have a competition, a Casas Tlan, and Jaime Longoria and myself decided to work together. And I have always felt that my strongest part in terms of as an artist is the color. And we decided that we were going to use my colors.
I think that the mural, the way Jaime and Malu explained it, tells a lot about the youth. And I have heard, you know, some good things about it. Although, it still needs to be explained, because I was there, it was explained to me, and there are students who have also asked, well, why did you choose that mural? What does it say? I think murals is something that needs to be explained, that I know what it means when I look at the whole mural. I told my son what it means, although for him it's a little harder to understand because I can't make a very clear presentation like the artist did.
The last 10, 15 years, Chicanos, Latinos have been using murals to communicate messages. At the same time that they were doing it, they were expressing aesthetic concerns. Now, when I came along to approach this wall, I thought, well, isn't it about time that we took all the aesthetic concerns that have been manifested in all those works and just put them into one work? And this figure here being that of a gangbanger, monster, which can also work as a police killer, is done in that style. The lines are produced often for their own beauty, for their own excitement, for their own joy. These two figures are gangbangers. And the reason I depicted them the way they are is that the one on the left is skeletal. Again, the left being that part which could think. But because it's not thinking, not really working, it's dead. And on the right, we have the passion. And it's my observation of gang structure that the brains of the outfit usually gets the passionate outfit in trouble and gets them killed. So that this group is the one that's responsible for the eventual death. And in combination with the monster down at the end, who actually commits the act of violence, you know, they destroy our community. The biggest enemy that we have at this time in this community is not any white oppressor, not any outside force. It is the gang youth who are failing their responsibility to become warriors for our people. And when I talk about warriors, I'm talking about political warriors, I'm talking about economic warriors, people who are willing to go out there and make the necessary sacrifices against their own interest for the betterment of the whole. And that means sitting down and working.
What happened here?
Well, somebody came over and threw some paint on this wall and are calling up for a meeting to discuss and create another wall. In other words, somebody that are boycotting this wall, they don't like the content. They expect another artist to paint about the history of the Mexican people. Now, this wall in itself, it has a political statement, you know. Yes, it isn't finished. This is not the first wall that is done. In terms of a political mural, this is not the first wall that is done in this way.
Proposal. We want a mural that we can understand, one more simple and clear, something that our community and others can understand and feel, one that has to do with our sufferings toward the school and our ancestors. Like Benito Juarez, with the participation of the students themselves, the student of our community, the student of Benito Juarez High School. We want a muralist of our community, like Marcos Raya, Aurelio Diaz, or Salvador Vega. Not someone who doesn't belong here and who doesn't know what we went through to get to school. We don't want Jaime Longoria because he doesn't belong here. We would like some changes in our community. We want a history, not a mentally high, rich, not understandable mural. Our proposal is made because we would like a new mural at Benito Juarez High School. We would like the artists mentioned before to present their projects that they have for Benito Juarez so the students and parents could judge, not only teachers. We want a general meeting in Zapata Park so students and parents could attend in the judging process. We want our radio stations to know about this. Television, newspapers, and magazines. Also March, Gatsaslan, and St. Procopius. We will see you all there. This petition and proposal was made by our students and the community of Pilsen Neighbors to stop the mural that is in process at Benito Juarez. See you all at the meeting, Zapata Park.
This is not a traditional thing. This is something that is something new and something that represents what the new generations are thinking of. It's not what the rest of the community thinks of or wants, but what they, the kids, want.
Can you tell us a little bit about what you think this mural means to you as a student in this community?
Well, being a black American in this neighborhood for the last maybe 16, 17 years, I feel that it explains a lot of the struggles and the stress that the Mexican American people went through.
Why do you think they put this mural on the wall of a high school?
Well, in a way, because it's mostly a Latin school, and it kind of explains what type of struggle the Mexican people had to go through as surviving in America, plus in their own land. I guess they feel that the same struggle is still going on. I mean, it's still the struggle for education, a struggle for the strive of better man. As I noticed, they have a lot of different working people, too, like the man with the hammer, which explains the workers' union, different thing which a lot of the Mexican people strive for, because they are a lot of the farmers of the land and the workers.
Well, the more people working at new ideas, the better everybody can be, better off anybody can be, right.
I think that it shows that the Latinos have a great advantage, that they're not what every people think they are. They have the freedom to learn, to further their education, because it's something that nobody can take away from them, and they can make something big of themselves, not just in the street like everybody says they are. They're somebody. The mural, it shows the student to further his education in order to become somebody. It's up to him in order to do, you know, to be somebody.
A small man called his name in the air, and his echoes were lost in the dreams of his children. Through their eyes, a story, how this time we couldn't lose the struggle for a school or third-hand clothes, the fight for a peace of mind, our pride back in our hands, the terror, a blink in a tiny sleep. And every day of their lives, they hear echoes in their mother's eyes, the tears that watch them grow from dim to heavy stroke colors on the walls for each child to see, the dreams awakened of long ago, and the small man who cries in the air.